Recording is on. Okay. Did you have a chance to read your book on Proverbs?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Is there anything in it you'd like to talk about before we get into what I have to share?
Contradictions. I don't know. I think it's the most contradictions in all the Bible. So it's kind of confusing on some verses.
Well, the one verse especially, rebuke a fool according to their folly, lest they're wise in their own eyes. Mm-hmm. And the next verse says, don't rebuke a...
Right, that's the one I'm talking about, right. I think it's Proverbs 5, maybe?
I'm not sure where it is, but I love that verse the best because it shows that, you know, these things that they say, they're not absolute. Mm-hmm. And there's always exceptions to them.
Maybe it depends on the fool that you're talking to.
Exactly, it does. So in one of the Three Stooges, Mo says to Curly, what kind of a fool do you think I am? And Curly says, is there more than one kind? And actually, there's about seven kinds listed in the book of Proverbs. The first one being the one that denies God. Mm-hmm. So, anyone else before we begin the screen show? One of the things that the book said that I'm going to disagree with, he indicated, I don't know if it was in last week's reading or this week's reading, that the Proverbs had nothing to do with the Old Testament law. And I think I think I'll be able to prove beyond a reasonable doubt that that's not so tonight, because well, the first law, the laws about loving God, having only God, not taking the name of the Lord in vain, honoring the Sabbath day, those are not found in Proverbs. But all of the laws concerning, you know, the second tablet, all of those are found. You know, honoring father and mother is over and over and over again. And adultery, the law against adultery is covered over and over and over again. About stealing and so forth, they're all there. Covetousness, I mean, desire is a big subject in the book of Proverbs. And so let's start the screen show here. And excuse me one second, I'm going to have to get some water or I'm going to run into a problem. So give me 1 minute. Okay, sorry about that. Just to start kind of the overview, there are five different books that are compiled together in the Proverbs. First one starts in chapter 1, of course, the book 2. The Proverbs of Solomon begin in chapter 10. Then in chapter 24, we have sayings belonging to the wise. Then in chapter 25, we have through 29, we have Hezekiah's compilation of Solomon's saying. And then we have the words of Augur and the words of Lemuel. So at some point, these were all put together, similar to the way the Psalms were all put together into one book. And so it looks like at least three out of the six come from Solomon himself. And let's just start with this one. The seven things. Abomination. Who could identify the word abomination? I mean, I think I mentioned it to you when we were talking about sexual sin Anybody remember what the definition is? It's actually rotting flesh. It's like roadkill with flies and stink. So these seven things, a proud look. Now, this is not something that would be against the law, and yet it's an attitude which would indicate that you're probably breaking the stated laws. A lying tongue, of course, that is, you shall not bear false witness. Hands that shed innocent blood, that, of course, is you shall not murder. A heart that devises wicked plans, that could be any of them. Feet that are swift in running to evil, and a false witness. So lying is in there twice. And then lastly, one who sows discord among the brethren. Now, which one in the church is the most common?
Discord.
Mm-hmm. Discord is the opposite of harmony. It's when the piano hits the bad note. You know, it's the proper chord, the proper harmony in the church is ruined by discord. And it seems like from time to time, this raises its ugly head no matter what you do or to try to stop it. Have you seen this to be true?
Do you think it's a power struggle, or what do you think?
Oh, it could be. It could be a power struggle. Especially, you know, if someone new comes in, like if a new pastor comes in, then there can be a power struggle. And sometimes there's people behind the scenes, you don't really know where it's coming from. And I think this is common in all organizations. I know that the fire department has their issues from time to time. And there always seems to be one person that's behind the scene and this kind of stuff. So for the most part, these are human body parts that are committing these sins that God hates. The tongue, the hands. The tongue would be anything that we would speak. The hands would be anything that we do. The heart would be, you know, the mind, will, and emotion of the person with wicked plans. Feet, which would take you from here to there. And then again, the second time the tongue speaks. And then the last one is also part of the hand, one that sows discord. They're planting a seed that will raise up and cause a problem in the congregation or in the family. You know, this is just as bad as if you have a family that has issues. You know, Christmas time and Thanksgiving time should be a time of blessing, not a time when you hate to see your relative. Mm-hmm. Any of you have any of that issue in your own family?
Political
issue?
Right now, yeah. With the election coming up, we saw a little bit of it. Not where we were, but over the phone, yeah. And on Facebook, over the week, we saw it.
I turn those people off so I don't see their feed. Mm-hmm. I had a guy argue with me privately. I put up a post which basically said, you know, the morality of the person is not the issue. They're both immoral people, but what are their policies going to be? And then I had another pastor argue with me in private message. And finally I told him, I said, look, you know, you have your opinion, I have my opinion. Please don't respond to this anymore. Mm-hmm. But it's, I don't like that either.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask a question? With one who sows discord, and then above it, feet that are swift and running to evil. I understand the one that sows discord, it starts the problem, but feet that are swift and running, as a pastor, do you see people that delight in jumping into a controversy? Is that what that means? Or they...
I think it's more more nefarious than that. It's people who know what's wrong, and yet they can profit somehow by doing wrong.
Like looting, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Exactly. That would be a good example of it.
But in the church body, what would be an example of feet that are swift in running to evil?
Well, let me think. You know, I don't know if I want to mention anything.
No, it's okay.
Personally, it's, happened.
No,
to
no,
me.
No. I don't mean in our
maybe Deb can come up with one.
No, I just wonder. Like, all right, how about this? How about like people that don't like change? Okay, and then if there's opposing views about what should be done. Are there people that like, well, I guess, yeah, there are people that like to.
Well, how about the time, maybe this was before you came, but when I first came, anybody could vote here. And so I said to the church, you know, look, the only qualification for voting would be that if you put something in the plate. And so I said to the church one day, I said, what would you do if, say, some cult down the road decided to come to church and they all dropped a dollar in the plate? Mm. And then they came to the meeting and they took your property away from you. Would that be, you know, would it be wise to keep this that way? No, mm-hmm. That wouldn't be wise at all. So it was changed. Mm-hmm. And then when some of the same people disagreed with policy later, they went out into the community knowing full well that people who were members like 10 years previously couldn't vote, that you had to come regularly in order to vote. And they knew that these people couldn't vote anymore, but they brought them in anyway just to anger them.
Okay.
That type of thing.
Right.
And so I have seen stuff like that. And
like stirring the pot.
Yeah.
Okay.
Or the time that somebody called the Child Protective Services on us and said we were beating our kids. Mm-hmm. And they came out, investigated it, and it wasn't, you know, it wasn't founded. Right. And, but it was just a way to harass us in a way, you know, I know who did it, but, they can't tell us who did it, but I know who did it, mm-hmm. because, you know, there was a power struggle going on. So that type of thing. But there could also be 1,000 different things in business that could be like this.
True, yeah. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Anyone else on this? So this is just, I mean, this is kind of like an overview proverb. Okay, sayings about the commandments. Honor your father and your mother. This is the list of proverbs that relate to that one. This is probably, of all of the Ten Commandments, this one is the one that is found the most in the book of Proverbs, because the book itself, or the books themselves, they're designed for teaching children. And so throughout, it's, you know, listen to your father's words. Don't neglect your mother's chastisement, that type of stuff. So I just put a couple of them here. Hear your father's instruction. Don't forsake your mother's teaching. Indeed, they're a graceful wreath to your head and ornaments about your neck. Now, in the East, when we show up in India, they always come and they bring a garland and they put it around our neck. I don't like it, but that's their tradition. And for them, they are honoring us, even though we probably don't deserve it. You know, they look up to us as being some great person. And so they honor with this wreath and garland. And so the proverb says, if you follow the instructions of this dad and this mom, that you will receive honor in your life. So that's the metaphor there. And then the other one, wise son makes the father glad, but a foolish son is a grief to his mother. And I mean, I think we all understand what that means.
Clearly Solomon's kids did not read these.
Rehoboam doesn't seem to have.
Some of them, you would think Solomon didn't read them.
He forgot about them.
Well, when you get off and don't serve God anymore, it becomes a problem. Mm-hmm. Because he gives, you know, he stops talking to you. Gives us over to a reprobate mind and is silent. So, honoring the father and the mother. Well, what if your father and your mother are no good? Well, you still have to have respect for them. But the hope is of Proverbs, the hope is that generation after generation of godly people will raise up their children to be godly people. And so that's the way, that's the philosophy of the book, at least. Anything else on that one? You want to write those down? I know you don't. Murder. The bloodthirsty. You know, this is, what is bloodthirsty? What figure of speech is that? It's hyperbole, is it not? They're not actually drinking blood, mm-hmm. but they hate the blameless, and a fool vents his anger. Of course, Jesus said, you know, if you're angry with your brother, you're guilty of murder, because the the anger comes from within, and then the act goes without. And so here again, we have that first scripture we looked at, hands that shed innocent blood. So you can't really get away. I mean, even the first murder in the Bible, when Cain slew Abel, he had this mark of Cain upon him. And, you know, I saw this in the prison when I used to work in the prison with people who were guilty of killing other people. They just couldn't shake the guilt of it. And so there's a warning here against a full vent of anger. I mean, anger is one thing, but when you get so angry that you want to take somebody's life, that's pretty angry. And if you ever watch any of these prison shows that are on TV, a lot of them, they just flew off the handle one day. They were ordinary people, and somebody did something that really irritated them. They just flew off the handle and killed somebody. And now they're in prison for the rest of their life. So we have to be careful about anger. On that one, anything? The wise quietly holds it back. How many times have you quietly held your anger back? Lots of times, right? You're steaming inside, but you grit your teeth and you don't do anybody the harm because you're a believer. Adultery, another big one. Let's look at the second one, starting in verse 3, because that's actually the first one in the list. The lips of an adulteress or an adulterer drip honey. Smoother than oil is her speech, but in the end she's bitter as wormwood. Wormwood is a metaphor for something that just cannot be consumed. Sharp as a two-edged sword, her feet go down to death. Her steps take hold of Sheol. She does not ponder the path of life. She's not a believer. She might be in the church in the morning, but she really isn't there. Her ways are unstable, and she doesn't know it. Now then, my sons, listen to me and do not depart from the words of my mouth. Keep your way far from her and do not go near the door of her house. Or, this is what will happen to you. You will give your vigor to others, your years to the cruel one. Strangers will be filled with your strength. Your hard-earned goods will go to the house of an alien, and you will groan at your final end when your flesh and your body are consumed. What do we call that? We call that syphilis right up until the 1940s when they figured out how to cure it. We call that AIDS, which they can't cure. We call that herpes, which they can't cure. And so to look at the beautiful woman who's an adulteress, she's going to drag you to hell. It's going to ruin your life here, and it's going to drag your flesh down to hell. Now, conversely, verse 18 says, let your fountain be blessed, rejoice in the wife of your youth, a lovely deer, a graceful doe, may her breast satisfy you at all times. May you be intoxicated always by her love. Why should you be intoxicated, my son, by another woman and embrace the bosom of an adulteress? And as you can see, there are 10, well, there may be more, but I have 10 different proverbs here that warn about the problems that will occur. And in one of them, it says her husband could kill you. I mean, that's one possibility when you mess around like that. There was a guy in Victor a number of years ago who thought he was Adonis. And he had a beautiful, beautiful wife. And he was spreading his seed all over the area. And one day a guy got a hold of him and cut his manhood off him, killed him. And so that's one possibility for adultery. The other possibility is, hatred and anger. And a further possibility is death by disease. And the fourth problem is ending up in hell. So in our society, it's all right, no big deal, but it is a big deal. It will ruin lives. What do you think about that?
It ruins more than just your life too. Mm-hmm. And one thing I saw in there with your wealth going to an alien land, I'm just picturing all the people that have to pay child support to 3 different women, and no matter how hard they work, they can never get ahead due to their choices of doing it.
Yep. I've seen it a lot over the years. And when it happens in the church, what do you do? It can't be allowed. Because if it's allowed, then Jesus said a little leaven leavens the whole lump. And if somebody in the church, if the young people in the church see that that's allowed, it'll be everywhere. I had a woman come to me one time from another church, a church in Canandaigua. And her husband was committing adultery against her. And I said, well, why are you talking to me? Why don't you talk to your pastor? And she said, well, he gives an awful lot of money to the church. He's the biggest giver in the whole church, and they won't do anything about it. Mm-hmm. And when you do something about it, then look out, because people will condemn you for it. Mm-hmm. Go ahead. Go ahead, Jim.
Been in a couple of churches where the pastor,
was the one,
and they didn't survive it. They were no longer the pastor once it was found out.
And the church didn't survive, did it?
No. Well, it tried, but that didn't work out. And the other one found a new pastor.
Back in the church that I first became a Christian in, the pastor ran off with a woman, and it limped along for years, but it never ever recovered, and now it's gone. That's the worst. I mean, that not only is a pastor doing that, not only is that adultery, but it's spiritual incest. Mm-hmm. And it's very difficult to come through that kind of stuff. There's a lot of other things that pastors do too. Sometimes they're cocaine addicts. And, you know, that would fall under, you know, the foolishness of intoxicants.
Some of the televangelists got caught with adultery, and that ended their televangelism.
Marvin Gorman came to Southeastern when I was there, and he preached a sermon. He had us all weeping, and, you know, he just phenomenal preacher. And then he went out and got into a problem with adultery. And Jimmy Swaggart turned him in. And then when Swaggart got involved in adultery, he was in the hotel room with a woman, and Marvin Gorman went outside and let the air out of the tires of his car. And when he came out, he said, "What are you doing, Jimmy?" And that was the end of Jimmy Swaggart. Mm-hmm. And, you know, one of my Bible school professors said, "You can't get away with it," because, you know, he was speaking to men, but, you know, in that group, the women are pastors as well, but he was speaking to men. He said, "The woman will tell somebody. She will tell her best friend, or she will tell her father, or she will tell her board member, or she will, you know, she will tell somebody, and you cannot get away with it." And I believed him. And so I've never had any problem like that. So it ruins lives. It ruins kids' lives. You know, then you got, you know, step family. Sometimes those don't work out too well. You know, there's just all kinds of things. The biggest cause of poverty in the United States is the split homes. You know, the husband and wife have enough money to operate as a family and barely get by. And then when they have to have two houses and two cars, and, you know, that everybody's living below their means. Really sad. Anything else on that one? Stealing. Okay, here is a proverb that actually refers directly to a law. "Men do not despise a thief if he steals to satisfy himself when he's hungry." That means starving. "But when he's found, he must repay sevenfold," which is what the law says. "He must give all the substance of his house." So there is a punishment for thievery. And if you have to go to court for that, you get caught for that. What happens when somebody shoplifts from Walmart? You know, we had a neighbor a few years ago, more than a few years ago, a lot of years ago. Decent person, never did it before, walked into Walmart and stole something. And that got arrested. It was in the paper. Shame, you know, just was messed up their life for a long, long time. It's probably been forgotten now, but when all your friends that you went to school with see your name in the paper that you've stolen something, horrible testimony. So in Proverbs, it says the prayer, this is actually a prayer proverb: "Do not deny me these things. Remove falsehood and lying. Give me neither poverty or riches, but feed me with the food I need. Or I shall be full and deny you and say, 'Who is God?' Or I shall be poor and steal and profane the name of God." And so here's a person that understands that you don't take anything out of this life. You come in with nothing, you go out with nothing. And so please, God, give me enough to get by, but not enough so that I forget you, and not so little that I have to steal to eat. What about that one? Would that be a good thing to teach kids?
I think that was my prayer for many, many generations. Still is. I still pray that.
And God has given us, you know, as a family, enough. I mean, we haven't gotten rich, but we've always had enough. And God has always taken care of us through his people in the church And so we thank God for that. I've never had to steal stuff. My father was a guy that was, you know, you could, if you went out drinking, he didn't care. And if you went chasing girls, he didn't care. But he did not put up with stealing. And he said, if I ever catch you stealing, I'll knock your head off. And we believed him. And so it was one of those things that out of fear, we never did. I did steal a pack of cigarettes one time when I was a teenager. But, you know, looking back, I think that's the only thing I've ever stolen in my life.
Thinking how many of our laws, you know, somebody goes into Walmart and steals something. It goes to court, gets appealed. You got to get lawyers. It takes weeks and everything. Where if it was just you stole, okay, it's $1,000 fine that you have to pay to Walmart.
Sevenfold. You steal $100, you pay back $7, and Walmart gets it.
Whatever it is, my point is, you know, it would be, it's just you get caught, that's what you're sentenced to pay back, and if you want to fight it, then you go to court. Otherwise, it's just there's. It just seems like this could free up a lot of court and discourage people stealing too.
Well, our court hardly ever says to the person who has stolen something, you got to pay the person you've harmed back. Mm-hmm. When I had my junk store in Canandaigua, if somebody stole something, sold it to me, I would get my money back if Canandaigua police were the ones that did the arrest. And the reason for that is when I started business, I went up there and I said, look, I'm going to keep track of everything I buy and who I buy it from. And if you're looking for something, you call me. If I have it, I'll give it to you. And then I just had a good working relationship with them. And they would call me and say, be on the lookout for this or be on the lookout for that. And I solved a major crime for them one time. And the defense lawyer said that the police had entrapped them and entrapped the criminal, but they didn't entrap them. What happened was, is the person came in, one person came in and told me who had committed this crime that the police were looking for. And I said to the person who told me that, I said, you better go tell your friends to get that stuff out of the house because I heard that the cops are coming right over there to get them. And so he ran out to tell his friends to get the stuff out of the house. I called the city police. They went down and caught him taking the stuff out of the house. And so they solved the crime. But the defense lawyer said that that the police had entrapped them. And they got away with doing it because I was a confidential informant. And the judge said, has this confidential informant solved other crimes? And they said, yes, several. And so, okay, it's a confidential informant. But they always made sure that I got my money back. But if it was the sheriff's department or the state police, I never got anything back. But it's not a good law. It's not a good way to do it. Caleb is right. They should have to pay stuff back, and then they wouldn't do it again, usually. Although I did have a guy sell me two stolen bicycles a few months apart. Got arrested for both of them. So there are stupid people that just are thieves.
I see the court system regularly where I work, and justice doesn't work here. Let's just put it that way. I've seen many times again where the court has told people to pay stuff back, and it just ends up as a judgment and the people never pay it back. It's a shame. They try and they hand it down that way, but they never get their money, even when the judge says they have to.
So what happens when a person who is a Christian has a reputation for stealing? I mean, it's a horrible testimony in the community. I mean, people make mistakes and they can get forgiveness for it, but this type of stuff is, you know, this is wisdom. You know, don't even do it. You're probably going to get caught eventually. You might not get caught right away, but you're going to get caught eventually. let him, it says in the New Testament, who steals. So this is assuming that somebody is in the church who is a former thief. Let him who steals steal no longer. Rather, let him labor so that he might have something to give to another. So salvation is just not stopping to steal. Salvation is to work and to go from a thief to a giver, which is the opposite. A thief and a non-thief is not the opposite. A thief and a giver is the opposite. Anything else on this one? You shall not bear false witness. Now, in the law, I think there are 16 death penalty sins. And one of them is to bear false witness in a capital case. So if somebody is on trial for their life and you come in and you bear false witness, you commit perjury at the trial to convict somebody of something that they did not do, you lose your life. And I mean, the false witness is, you know, testimony and sworn testimony, but it comes down to a life of truth or a life of lying. Jesus said, let your yes be yes, and let your no be no. So if someone asks you a question and says, did you go here or there? And you say, and they say, no. Then you say, are you sure? Then they say, no. You don't swear to God after that. You just have the emphatic no. It's like the truly, 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 I say unto you. So it's the second emphatic, which is not, you know, is not a sworn testimony. It is the person who is a person of truth. And so the emphatic yes or the emphatic no should be enough. If you have the character, if you are known as a person of truth. So here's a couple on that one. What's desirable in a person is loyalty. It's better to be poor than a liar. A false witness will not go unpunished. The same thing is true for lesser crimes. Suppose the witness was in the trial and he said, I saw so-and-so steal whatever it is. And then they find out that that's perjury. Then the person who testified falsely in that case would have to pay the sevenfold. So Jesus said, swear not at all. Let your yes be yes and your no be no. Anything on that? Are you seeing how Christianity and Judaism really are not divided? I mean, are these classes showing you that what Jesus taught was actually Old Testament biblical stuff and the church has neglected it for a long time?
But why do you think that is, Kevin?
Why has the church neglected it?
Yeah.
Anti-Semitism? You know, the Jews were called Christ killers. And they've been persecuted for a long time.
Yeah.
The other thing is a false understanding of, and you've probably heard it many times, don't say anything to me about tithing. That's Old Testament.
Right.
And so that's old. We have the new. We have the superior. But what is lost in all of that is what we have that is new is based on the old. And some things just haven't changed. The Ten Commandments haven't changed. And the covenant has changed in the sense that, I mean, we talked about the five different covenants of Adam and Noah, which include all people, and then the individual covenant of Abraham, which is circumcision, which is not, you know, not upon the Gentiles, and the covenant of Moses, is not on the Gentiles, except for the the things that are listed in Acts 15, which are the things that are in the covenant of Adam and the covenant of Noah. But almost nobody understands that. Almost nobody that I talk to understands that there are actually multiple covenants in the book that we call the Old Testament, and that two of them are binding upon everybody. But it's, I don't know if it's just nobody's teaching it.
It's too bad, you know, and maybe that's why we see, you know, that, you know, for example, the divorce rate is the same in the church as outside of the church. You know, we're just not following God's word. And we're not teaching it and studying it, and we're seeing the cost of that.
Here, let's look at a root cause of the divorce problem. Isn't it a lack of understanding of the wisdom as it is found in the book of Proverbs? If every young man and every young woman looked for the type of character in their prospective spouse that Proverbs shows that they should be, would there be less divorce? I think there'd be considerably less. Mm-hmm. One time I was in Florida, Sean was there too, and we went to one of Andy Stanley's McDonald type franchise churches where Andy Stanley does the preaching. They have a local pastor that takes care of the people in the community, but Andy does all the preaching. And he preached one of the best messages I've ever heard in my life. And it was, be the person that you're looking for in a spouse. And, you know, that's it. But a lot of times, people, like men, tend to look only at the outside physical appearance. And women tend to look at the guy that's a lot of fun. And the guy that's a lot of fun when you're 18 is not a guy that's a lot of fun when you're 55. And a lot of times, everything that they liked about each other when they were young is what they can't stand about each other when they grow up.
You weren't much fun when we dated.
and I'm not much fun now either.
No, I could say that with all honesty.
But I can't tell you how many women have said to me, he was so much fun. We did this. We danced. We went places. And then she's stuck at home with kids, and he's off dancing with somebody else and drinking with somebody else. And what they liked is now what they hate. But if people would just, you know, look for a godly person who has wisdom in their spouses, things would work out a lot better for a lot more people. You're still gonna have the fools, but let the fools marry the fools. Mm-hmm. I mean, the scripture is pretty clear, you know, Christians should marry Christians, Jews should marry Jews, but just because they're so-called Christian doesn't necessarily mean they're following the precepts of wisdom. Just because they show up in church, or just because they said some prayer somewhere, doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to be a good spouse. Right. So, lack of wisdom leads to the divorce rate. Anything else on this false witness one? Yeah, and let me just say this. If young people would deliver on what they promise when they're dating, there'd be a lot less divorce too. And that is a form of false witness too, to not deliver on what you promise. Oh, we'll be together. I'll love you forever. I'll take care of you. And then it doesn't happen. That's a lie. Hmm. Anything else in this one? Thou shalt not covet. This one goes to everything. This one goes to stealing. This one goes to adultery. The 10th commandment, you shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbor, his house, his job, his wife, his ox, his ass. You shall not desire them, which is the big sin that Jesus said, you know, when a man looks at a woman in adultery, he's committed adultery in his heart because he's desired something that he's not allowed to have, or she, depending on the situation. And so here in Proverbs, it's talking about the loose woman, and it could, you know, it has to do with the loose man too. Don't desire her beauty. If there's no inner beauty, no amount of outer beauty is going to work, because, you know, I was a fairly good looking young guy, and now look at me, bald and fat and, you know, wrinkled and all that kind of stuff. When I was young, the girls liked me, but they liked me for my outer beauty. And that's not what lasts. Do not desire his delicacies. This is somebody who's rich. Covetousness. Oh, I'd like to have some. I'd like to do business with him, and I can make some money, and I can eat the nice food that he eats. But the delicacies of the wicked rich guy is deceptive food. Do not eat the bread of selfish man. What's the number one cause of divorce? Selfishness in one or both. Do not be envious of evil men or desire to be with them. Oh, you know, I know this rich guy and I know that rich guy. And yeah, they're my buddies. Don't be envious of people that are doing wrong. Covetousness is a bad sin because it leads to all kinds of other sins. The love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. You know, the New Testament says the same thing, just in different words. Paul said, I thought I was a perfect Jew. As to the law, blameless. And then I read the 10th commandment, and there was all kinds of covetousness within me. Ever read the book of Romans? That's what Paul says. I realized that all my desires were wrong, even though I kept the law perfectly on the outside. How about this one? We're being honest here, right? We all have to fight against this one. Desire. There are a couple of riddles in Proverbs. And I think that this has to be my favorite proverb. Who has ascended into heaven and descended? At that time, who had? Nobody. Written sometime probably after Hezekiah was king, because this chapter 29 is the fifth section, which is placed after the words of Solomon that Hezekiah had collected. Who has ascended into heaven and descended? Who has gathered the wind in his fist? Who could do that? Is there any human being that can gather the wind in their fist? Who's wrapped the waters in his garment? There's a big puddle, and somebody took their garment off and soaked it up with their clothes. Who's able to do that with the oceans and the lakes? Has to be somebody with a pretty big garment. Who's established all the ends of the earth? What is his name or his son's name? Jewish people will tell you that God doesn't have a son. But Augur knows, Even though he says in the previous verses, he says, I'm about the dumbest guy that ever lived, and I don't know much about God. But then he propounds this riddle that can only be God, and the question is, what is his son's name? What is his son's name? He has a son, and he has a name. Now, I want you to compare that with this verse. No one has ascended into heaven but he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness. Even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that whoever believes in him will have eternal life. So we have two passages of Scripture, one from Proverbs chapter 29, or 30, I guess, and 31 is the virtuous woman chapter. So this is chapter 30. Jesus is speaking to Nicodemus, and here we have, you know, the John 3:16 verse follows this, but so many people just look at that John 3:16 verse, God so loved the world, that they don't read the verses before it and after it. One of the most striking verses in that passage is verse 36, that says, he who does not believe in the Son does not have eternal life, yet the wrath of God will abide upon that person. So he's speaking to Nicodemus, and Nicodemus is asking him questions because Jesus gives him the answer about the wind. You know, the wind blows where it will. And Nicodemus says, how can these things be? And Jesus says, no one has ascended into heaven but he who's descended. Now, Nicodemus was a ruler of the Jews, so he certainly knew Proverbs chapter 30, verse 4. So he understands what Jesus is talking about, that God has a son and that he should know what his name is. Because Nicodemus is there to find out. No, he says, nobody can do the things that you do unless God is with him. So he's there for that. And then Jesus answers him. Basically, he answers a question with a question. This is kind of a question. Although there's no question mark at the end of it, but this, no one has ascended into heaven. The real question is, what does this passage in Proverbs mean? Surely you know what it means. And so here I am. But secondly, he says, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. So we go back to the story of the fiery serpent. And the children of Israel were bitching and moaning and complaining, and they didn't like their food, and they loathe this manna that comes down out of heaven. And God sent the fiery serpents, and they were biting the people, and they were dying. And Moses prayed for the people, and Moses was told to lift up a serpent. And I showed you the medical symbol, which is still used to this day, the healing of the serpent. As they looked at the serpent in faith, they were healed. And so Jesus says, I have to be lifted up on the pole. This, you know, we used to have a song, which I hated, you know, was just lift Jesus higher, lift Jesus higher, lift him up for the world to see. Well, what they're really singing is crucify the Lord. Yeah. Because that's what this passage means. But, you know, without any understanding, people were singing that song. And so Jesus is saying, yes, I'm the one who came down and I'm about to ascend back, but I have to be lifted up like Moses lifted up the serpent. So that, my friends, I think is the coolest passage in Proverbs. What do you say about that?
That was the one I had a question about when I was reading the book about, but you answered it. Do Jews believe in the Son, that God has a Son? So did they believe in the Trinity at all? And where did he get that question if they didn't?
I don't think they had any concept of Trinity, because hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. Mm-hmm. That's the first verse that they taught everybody.
But what about Genesis? Like, let us. They never questioned that?
Well, you know, that's the most unusual where Elohim is the most unusual word in that it is plural, but singular. And I think it's the only one in Hebrew that is. Hmm. And so, but we do see the Spirit of God moving upon the waters and, but we see the Spirit of God and we see the Creator God, but I don't know if they would equate Creator God with Father God. Mm-hmm. You know, as you can probably tell, the revelation to the people increases as the more books are written. Like, I don't think anybody in Abraham's time or before, or even in the time of Moses, would understand any idea of a triune God. Mm-hmm. It just wasn't there. Just like they didn't have any understanding of eternal life. You know, Sheol is the place of the dead where the worms eat the body, and you know, that's where everybody's going. And they don't come to the understanding that there's a life after that, you know, for some time. So when Cain is dead, he's dead. You know, they're not thinking that he's going to be resurrected. It's not until, it's not, well, you know, it's there, but it's there in seed form. Your brother's blood cries to me from the ground, which would indicate he's still speaking. And of course, the author of Hebrews says, you know, the blood of Christ, which speaks better than the blood of Abel, is now speaking, you know, forgive them, or forgive. So it's a progressive thing, which is the, you know, I know that not everybody here took the New Testament class that we did first, but the struggle between the Sadducees and the Pharisees was this. The Sadducees only accepted the first five books of the Bible, and they said that there's no resurrection in it. And Jesus said, well, have you not read where it says, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? Is God the God of the living, or God the God of the dead? So in other words, he proved that there was a verse in there that proved resurrection, yet they wouldn't accept it because it was found more in the prophetic books, which we have not really gotten to yet. But there's a lot about resurrection in the prophets. And, you know, so that's post-David stuff.
Even so, David himself, though, spoke of his being living after death, I believe, when he's talking about his son or son. I don't know. I forget exactly where, but I thought David was talking about his life after death somewhere. I don't remember where.
Well, you know, it's in the Psalms in, you know, in seed form. So that's probably what you're thinking. Because David wrote most of them, or many of them. Anything else on this? We're almost out of time. Can we take 10 minutes and talk about at least one thing in Song of Solomon?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Okay. There are three verses here. I'm going to just mention this just with a sentence. There's three verses that talk about the proper time for love, which is after the wedding. There's section here on how she feels about him. And there's a section on how he feels about her. And then in chapter 3, verses 6 through 11, that's the wedding itself. And then after that, it's the garden. And the garden is the sexual relationship. And so prior to the wedding, he says, the garden is locked. A garden is locked is my sister, my bride. A garden, a rock garden locked, and a spring sealed up. So they're waiting for the day of the wedding. And three verses later, you are a garden spring, a well of fresh water and streams flowing from Lebanon. And somewhere in here, there's a verse about an actual gate. In chapter 4:16, it calls for the north wind to come and the south wind to come and make my garden breathe out fragrance. So the smell of a clean and perfumed bride on her wedding day, he calls for the wind to come so he can smell it in anticipation. And the time will come when he comes into the garden, he's able to eat the fruits of the garden. Chapter 5, I've come into my garden. So here he is there. I've gathered my myrrh along with my balsam. So he smells good. He's clean too. I've eaten my honeycomb and my honey. I've drunk my wine and my milk. Eat, friends, drink, imbibe deeply, O lovers. And in chapter 6, it mentions it again. So what did your book say about it?
The garden or the whole?
The whole song. Well, what was their take on the, his take on the book itself? There's been throughout the centuries, there's been a certain group of people that have said, this can't be about real marital love, because if it is, it's pornographic.
They mentioned that in the book. And they also mentioned how, you know, the parallelogram with the Lord and stuff, but they kind of discarded that as well, the author of the book, saying that, I think he was basically saying it is between a bridegroom and a bride relationship, was his take on it.
Many Jewish scholars have said, you know, because if you look at the way traditionally, obviously after this time, where brides were sold to their husbands at a young age, they wouldn't know anything about this type of courtship and anticipation and waiting and stuff like that. It's okay, give me 3 cows and you can have her, and you know, which is what it came to be later. And so the Jews have tended to say this is a story about how God marries Israel. And the Christians said, no, no, no. God doesn't like Jews. He likes Christians. And this is a story about Jesus and the bride of Christ. And I don't buy either of those. I think this is a real honest to goodness love story that is put in the form of a song and was probably performed on a stage in a way to tell people to wait until their wedding and do things right. That'd be my guess. That's my opinion anyway. As I say, there are many other opinions from scholars on this. What do you think? Is it pornographic? Everything's in metaphor. You know, the lock, the garden locked. You know, it's can't get in there. Somebody.
I don't think it's any different than love letters that were exchanged. I don't know that they are anymore, but there was a time when courtships, that's what it was about, was exchanging letters to one another during courtship and getting to know each other and their desires for one another. I look at this as that.
But there's, you know, there's sometimes it's hard to see, it's hard to understand in some cases who's speaking, because there are the daughters of Jerusalem speaking, the groom is speaking, the bride is speaking.
Isn't there a shepherd too?
I think so, yes. So different people are speaking, but it doesn't delineate. You have to figure out, you know, if it, in the context, if it's speaking to a man or to a woman, or if it's the daughters of Jerusalem who are probably the bridesmaids. I mean, the groom is obviously Solomon, not Jesus. because he, you know, he's a king and he's named, and he's riding on a some sort of a conveyance. Anything on this?
Where does multiple wives come in here?
Predates it for sure. He had what, 900 concubines?
700 wives, 300 concubines.
I think it's the other way around.
Or the other way around.
300, yeah, 300 wives.
700.
Yeah.
God.
Too many.
So is so, this favorite?
I don't know. It doesn't say.
For the moment, it was.
Yeah.
You know, most of those concubines were not, they didn't sleep with them.
No, but they.
You couldn't possibly. I mean, if you had 1,000 women to sleep with, it would take you 3 years to get through the, you know, through the list. More than, you know, that isn't going to happen.
No, but the sad part is they weren't allowed to have anyone else. They were property.
And why were there so many? Because of wars. Mm-hmm. The men were killed in the war.
You know, that's a problem for people that question Christianity and the Bible. You know, like, why was that allowed? And why didn't Jesus do something? That's a famous one. Why didn't Jesus address that and do something about it?
He did address it. Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any reason at all? Was the question. And the Pharisee said, if she burns the toast, you can divorce her. And the Sadducee said, no, the only way you can divorce her, if she's been sexually immoral. And so there was a big argument between the two camps. And Jesus said, didn't you read in the beginning that the man should leave his father and mother and cleave unto his wife? And the two should be one flesh. So the intention from the beginning, Jesus said, was one man, one woman. Mm-hmm. And the people that say that Jesus never said anything about homosexuality, that same verse applies.
Right.
So they weren't doing the right thing all along. They weren't doing the right thing. Even Moses had a number of wives. We haven't been too good when it comes to sexuality over the centuries.
It is disappointing, you know.
It is. Anything else?
Is the Song of Solomon poetic or a poetic form or just?
Yes.
Prose, poetic.
It's all in poetic. Every verse of it is poetic. It's mostly the synonymous parallelism. Second half of the verse says the same thing as the first half. The books that are completely poetic are Job, Psalms, Ecclesiastes, and Song of Solomon. And when I was in Bible school, they treated them as a segment in and of themselves, whole class on Hebrew poetry. Mm-hmm. Anything else? It's so nice to see you every Sunday night. I appreciate it.
Good night.
Good night.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Good night, everybody.
Good night. Have a good week.
Good week.
You too.
You too.